So this lecture we'll talk about frequency compensation of amplifiers. In the last lecture we had discussed stability, so let us quickly revise what we had studied there. What we had discovered was that the transfer function must have at least three poles for it to potentially be unstable under negative feedback. When will such an amplifier be unstable? If at the unity gain frequency the transfer function has a phase margin less than or equal to 0 or a phase less than or equal to minus 180 degrees, then the amplifier will be unstable and it will oscillate under negative feedback. If it has a phase margin greater than 0, then the amplifier is stable, but for making sure that the ringing is minimal, a phase margin greater than or equal to 45 degrees is desirable. How do we achieve a 45 degree phase margin? So if you look at the Bode plot, the way to achieve a 45 degree phase margin is that in the magnitude plot there can be only one pole above the unity gain or 0 dB frequency, and the second pole must be at the unity gain frequency. Such a Bode plot has a phase margin of 45 degrees. We also saw last time that high gain amplifiers almost always have three or more poles, and therefore they are almost always unstable. Okay, so now let us see what to do. So we say that something has to be changed or added to an unstable amplifier to make it stable. Now, whatever that thing is that we add, or that process or that method, is called frequency compensation. Now, there are many probably 36 techniques that you will find in the literature on how to compensate an amplifier. There are different circuit techniques. You will learn some of them formally in the control systems course. Here we will just learn one technique which is very popular in amplifier design, and a large number of commercial op amps use it. It's called dominant pole compensation. Okay, so let's look at this. So let's look at this Bode plot which offers some fictitious high gain amplifier that happens to have three poles. So the magnitude plot is flat for low frequencies, and then there is a P1 and a P2 and a P3, and the gain falls at minus 20, minus 40 and minus 60 dB per decade, and all three poles are above the unity gain frequency. Here is the unity gain frequency. So if you look at the phase plot, at P1 the phase is minus 45 degrees, at P2 minus 135, at P3 minus 225, and at unity gain frequency somewhere in between minus 225 and minus 270. So the actual phase is whatever, and if we add 180 to it, we are saying the phase margin is of the order of minus 60 degrees. Phase margin is minus 60 degrees, it must be at least plus 45 degrees. Okay, so what does dominant pole compensation do? Let us see. So this is the same Bode plot. What dominant pole compensation technique says is, we need to modify this Bode plot. And if we want a 45 degree phase margin, then the second pole must be at the unity gain frequency. Now, what does that mean for the Bode plot? That means that for frequencies less than P2 and up to some P1, the gain will have a slope of 20 dB per decade. So, if you have to draw a line at 20 dB per decade, starting with P2 at unity gain frequency. So, let us say we draw a line like that. Then it comes here. Actually, I have drawn it. So, let us draw it. Okay. So here is a line. So we draw a line, we say we make P2 the unity gain frequency. What does that do to P1? So this has to be 20 dB per decade. So we say P1 has to be here, the modified P1. Okay, so this is what we are saying. We make or we move the dominant pole from P1 to some much lower frequency so that at P2 the gain becomes 1. Alright, so that's what we do. The dominant pole is moved to the left. This is dominant pole compensation. When this is done, we'll get, okay, so let's draw the rest of the Bode plot. So, okay, so from P2, the gain will fall at minus 40 and then at minus 60. All right, and then if we draw the phase, then the phase will be minus 45 at this modified P1. Then it will become 90 and the phase will stay constant until the second pole is encountered, which is starting here, one decade before P2. And then the phase plot will simply follow the original, because P2, P3 are the same. We are assuming that P2, P3 are not changed. We are moving only P1 to the left. Alright. So we say, let us call this modified dominant pole as P1C, C for compensated. And if we do this, if we do this, then we will get a phase margin of plus 45 degrees. So this technique is called as dominant pole compensation, moving the dominant pole P1 to the left. All right. Now let's do quick numericals for the op amp 741. We know that the 741 low frequency gain is about 100,000. We say let the second pole be at 1 megahertz. In fact, we have discussed this very briefly, that the 741 has a unity gain frequency of 1 megahertz. So we'll say let the unity gain frequency be 1 megahertz, and then where should the dominant pole be? Alright, so we know that the gain bandwidth product is 1 megahertz, so gain times the new bandwidth, which is P1C, must be equal to P2. So we say 100,000 times P1C must be 10 raised to 6. So P1C is 10 hertz. So in this plot, P1C is 10 hertz. Alright, the 3 dB frequency of the 741 is 10 hertz. I have this nagging suspicions that we have discussed this sometime, but that's okay. This is a revision. So what this means is that when we do dominant pole compensation, the minus 3 dB frequency will become very small. 10 hertz is a very small number, which is not good, of course. Nobody wants really, I mean, ideally, I don't want an amplifier which has a 3 dB frequency of 10 hertz. But I don't have a choice. If I don't compensate, the amplifier doesn't even work. It is useless. So in order to make it useful, I have to do this compensation and I have to live with it. This is a price. This is a sacrifice I must make to have an op amp that at least works, that at least when I put it under negative feedback, it will behave as an amplifier and not start oscillating. All right. But okay. So what is the point? How will we use an amplifier whose gain starts dropping at 10 hertz? Most signals in the world have frequencies greater than 10 hertz. In fact, the only realistic signals that have frequencies less than 10 hertz are human body signals, like the heart rate is about 1.2 hertz or something. That is all. Most signals have more than 10 hertz. And yet, 741 remains a widely used op-amp. So how does this happen? Again, I think we've discussed this. So let us quickly give the answer to this question. The answer lies in negative feedback. We go back to the first lecture of this series. We had studied that the gain bandwidth product remains constant under negative feedback. So for the open loop 741, the gain bandwidth product is 1 megahertz. What that means is and again is 100,000. If I put negative feedback and if I have a closed loop gain of 20, then the bandwidth will be 50 kilohertz, because the gain bandwidth product, 50 kilo times 20 is 1000 kilo, which is 1 megahertz. So under closed loop gain, my bandwidth increased. And 50 kilohertz is a respectable bandwidth. And in fact, so for audio applications, I need a bandwidth of 20 kilohertz. So I can use the 741 in a 7 closed loop configuration for, let's say, for audio applications up to a gain of, let's say if this is 20, so this will be 50, up to a gain of 50. All right. So this is the answer to this question. Not this question. Yeah, this question. What is the use? The use is that under closed loop, the frequency that it can be used up to is much larger. And so these are usable op-amps. Of course, now if you look at the op-amp you used in the buck converter assignment, perhaps those had much higher unity gain frequencies also, because technology has evolved allowing higher bandwidths than 1 megahertz. The 741 you recall was first built in 1967 or something. So things have improved. Not a lot, but they have improved. All right. So now he has the next question. So we say, well, we are going to use dominant pole compensation to make a circuit, make an amplifier stable. But we need to learn how to actually implement this in an actual amplifier. So let's learn this through an example. So here is a three-stage amplifier, which is kind of, well, basically it is the same structure as the high performance amplifier we designed. I have just taken the first three stages of that five-stage amplifier we had designed. I'm not sure if the numbers are the same, but they are similar. Well, they are slightly different, but any other, you know how to read this amplifier and how to analyze this amplifier. The reason I've taken three stages is because if you want negative feedback, we'll in a few slides we'll connect this output of this amplifier through resistors to the input, and the gain from the input to the output has to be negative. So I took three stages. Our five stage amplifier from the input to the output had a positive overall gain. I wanted a negative overall gain so that we put, when we do feedback, it will be negative. All right. So this amplifier happens to have a gain of minus 80 to 100. Now let us find its dominant pole frequency. What is the dominant pole frequency of such a system? We use a time constant method, right? So we say the dominant pole frequency is 1 over the sum of the time constants of the circuit. Now this circuit has 4 time constants because it has 4 nodes. So at high frequencies, this emitter and this emitter will be grounded. So we have 4 nodes, 1, 2, 3, 4. We'll assume the source to be ideal. So 4 nodes, so each node will have some capacitance, and then we find the resistance at that capacitance, and so we get the 4 time constants. So here is the expression for the 4 time constants. Let us go through this, because this is also kind of a revision of the using the time constant method. So the first is the time constant at this node. So the capacitance at this node is the C pi of this transistor, because for finding the time constant, we'll short this in the voltage source to ground, and so it'll be a C pi from here to ground. And the resistance seen by this C pi is approximately 1 by G1. It is the resistance looking up the emitter of a transistor, and as we have seen before, that is approximately 1 by G1. So that is a first time constant. The second time constant is at this node, which of course is the collector of Q1 and base of Q2. So first, what is our total capacitance at this node? So there is the, okay, so we'll use Miller's theorem. So there is a C mu here. So the C mu on the output side will be C mu here from this node to ground. This node is ground, so there will be C pi 2 from this node to ground. And also the Miller due to the C mu of Q2. will be C mu 2 times 1 plus the gain of this. So, okay, so first let's look at the resistances. C mu 1, C pi 2, C mu 2, 1 plus the gain of this stage. What is the gain of this stage? Gm 2 times the resistance at this node. The resistance at this node is R3 parallel R pi 5 of the R pi of the Q5. So that is this, the total capacitance. What is the resistance at this node? The Thevenin's resistance seen by this total capacitance, it is R1 parallel R pi 2. All these we've seen before, so I'm just revising. So R1 parallel R pi 2. Okay, that is the second node. The third node is this. So this is very similar to this. So this C mu 1, so there is C mu 2 here, C pi 2, so C pi 5 here, and then 1 plus GM 5 R8 times C mu 5. Three capacitances, C mu 2, C pi 5, and C mu 5 times 1 plus the gain of this, which is GM 5 R8. So that's the capacitance. The resistance is R3 parallel R pi 5. So that is the third term. The fourth term comes from this node. So the Miller capacitance on the output is C mu 5, and the resistance seen by C mu 5 is R8. So we get these four time constants. Okay, let's put numbers which I have put here. I will not go through these. Achha. C pi and C mu I have taken as 50 picofarads and 5 picofarads. So these actually, so let's go back to this this circuit. So this you can see, I have taken this from an LTSpice schematic. So I actually simulated this circuit in LTSpice. And the transistor I used was 2 and 2, 2, 2, 2. Now when you do any analysis, actually I don't remember, when you do a dot OP, I'm not sure if this happens when you do other analysis, but when you do a dot OP, SPICE, LTSPICE generates a file which is dot TXT. And if you look under view, you will see a SPICE error log. So you open that SPICE error log, which is a text file. It's actually not an error log. It actually gives all the small signal parameters of each of these transistors. So you open that error log, it will tell you the GM, the RPi, all of it for each transistor. It also gives the two capacitances, the CPi and CMU. So I got these values for CPi and CMU from that file. They are approximately, these I have rounded them off to nice whole numbers. But this is about 50 pico, this is 5 pico. All the transistors have a 1 milliamp current, the beta is 200, so everything else comes out. Okay, so if we calculate all these four time constants, the tau 1 is 1.25 nano, tau 2 is 2400 nano, tau 3 is 3800 nano, and tau 4 is 40 nano. So this tau 3 is the largest, and that is of course because of this Miller capacitance. You can see that this term has this gain is 200, and that and this gain is what, 40 into 2, I think. Okay, anyway, this is smaller than, 5 parallel 11 is obviously smaller than 5. So that is why this is the largest term. Alright, and then if we calculate from these taus, the dominant pole frequency, it comes out to be 25 kilohertz, the sum of these. Okay, now I did this in SPICE. So I drew the Bode plot. So this is the Bode plot. Now let's study this a little bit. First of all, there is a low frequency. You can see this falling. This is due to what? Why does the gain fall at low frequencies? It is because of this C1 and C3, the low frequency response. So when C1 and C3 start becoming open circuits, the gain of these two stages starts reducing it will become minus RC by RE, as you recall. So that is here. You are not concerned about it, but it's good to read the Bode plot. Okay, now this is minus, actually the gain is minus. What that means, A0 is the magnitude, but because the gain is negative, the phase of the midband frequency response will be minus 180 degrees, okay, because there is a negative sign. So this is the midband response, and then the first pole is here. Now you can see this is kind of a just dropping like that. It is not easy to, in fact, so the next question is, where are the poles? If you don't see, when we draw by hand, they're nice 20 dB, 40 dB. Here you can't identify anything. But the other thing we notice is, so this phase is minus 180. Let's look at the phase. So each, you recall, each pole will give minus 90 degrees of phase. So this originally is minus 180 at low frequencies. We go down, 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 down. The phase here is minus 660 degrees. This is minus 180. This is minus 660. How much is that? 280, 268, 480. 480 degrees of phase from here to here. Each pole gives 90. So there are 90 times 5 is 450. So there are 5 plus poles in this circuit. And this phase is still dropping. Eventually it's going to go drop to one more pole and then it's going to become flat. This is a nice circuit. You should actually simulate it yourself. It's good to play around with it. So there are 6. Now how many I said? 5. 6 poles in this circuit. It's crazy. Let's see the phase margin. 0 dB. What is the phase? The phase 0 dB is here. At 0 dB, the phase is somewhere here. Maybe minus 500. Minus 500. And this minus 180 we should take away because that is a low frequency. So minus 500 and 180 less is 400. So 380. Minus 380 is a phase, plus 180 degrees is a phase margin. So minus 380 plus 180. This is minus 200 is the phase margin. Minus 200. It's an incredibly unstable amplifier. We want the phase to be greater than zero phase margin, and it is minus 200. Okay, that was one thing. The other, my earlier question was, how do we find out where the poles are? So the gain. The gain plot is not very useful in finding the pole locations. The phase plot is much better because we know that at exactly the pole location, the pole will give a phase difference of 45 degrees. So if you look at 180 here, then minus 180, minus 45, minus 225 somewhere here is the first pole. Then you add another 90 degrees, I mean subtract 90 degrees, minus 225, minus 90. 45 from the first floor, 45 from the second pole. So minus 315 is the second pole. So that is somewhere here. And so on, third, fourth. So like that, if you find P1 and P2, you get 25 kilohertz and 780 kilohertz. Now, of course, it's nice to see that the Bode plot first pole 25 kilo matches our calculated value 25 kilo nicely, which is good. So, okay, so we say now these are the gain and the first two poles. Now we want to make the amplifier stable. So we must make P2 the unity gain frequency. Currently, P2... Where was P2? It was somewhere here. So see the gain. The gain is minus 40 dB. So you have to bring this down, to zero so that the whole thing comes down. Okay, so we do the calculation. So we say for a 45 degree phase margin, gain times the modified pole location of the dominant pole must equal 780 kilohertz, which gives us the dominant pole frequency to be 95 hertz. currently it is 25,000 hertz, so we need to reduce the dominant pole from 25,000 to 95, which is a factor of about 260. All right, so this is what we need to do. Now we need to ask ourselves, how are we going to do this in the circuit? So we look at the expression for P1 and we say we should change, of course we have to change something in P1, right? So we say we should change the largest time constant. All right, the way to change P1 is to change the largest time constant, because in fact it is the largest time constant that gives the dominant pole frequency. So we look at the expression for, okay, which is tau 3 and where is tau 3. So tau 3 is 1, 2, 3. This is tau 3, the third time constant, and we saw that time constant corresponded to this node, the capacitance and resistance at this node. All right, so we say okay, and this is the expression and these are the numbers. So we say to reduce P1 to 95 hertz, we must increase tau 3 by a factor of 260. Now tau 3 consists of a resistance, an effective Thevenin resistance, and the total effective capacitance. So we have to increase tau 3. We can either increase R, the effective R, or we can increase the capacitance. Which one shall we increase? Let's think about the resistance first, and then we'll think about the capacitance. So if we increase the resistance, interestingly, so let's look at the Bode plot. Okay, now first of all, if we increase the resistance, which is this, R3 parallel R5. Now R3 parallel R5, let's go back to the circuit. R3 parallel R5 is the resistance at this node. Increasing R3 parallel R5 will increase the gain of this, because the gain of Q2 is GM2 times R3 parallel R5. So if we increase this, the gain of Q2 will increase by the same factor as tau 3 increases. All right. Of course, you will ask a question, how on earth can we increase this by a factor of 260? But that is a second question. The first question is, let us see what this does to the Bode plot. Assume that it is possible to increase R3 parallel R5 by a factor of 260. What does it do to the Bode plot? So this was our, this is a conceptual schematic of the Bode plot. Now if we increase R3 parallel R5, what will happen? P1 moves back, but the gain also increases. So if you actually plot this, this is what it does. Increasing R3 causes the gain to increase and P1 to move. So our goal of reducing P1 is achieved, right? But what happened? What is the phase margin after we of this red? If once we increase the R3 parallel R5, this is a Bode plot, we still have 3 poles above the unity gain frequency. The rest of the poles did not move, P2 did not move down. Our goal was to make P2 move down so that P1 comes here and then we get a phase margin of 45 degrees. So the dominant pole compensation assumes that P2 comes down and the low frequency gain remains the same. The low frequency gain should not change. If that also increases, there is no improvement in the phase margin. This amplifier is as unstable as before. So, increasing the resistance does not affect the phase margin. So, our purpose is not served. So, the only thing we can do is we have to increase the capacitance. Alright, actually, of course, yeah, okay. So, we say, well, we need to increase this total quantity. So the total quantity is 10060. This is picofarads, by the way. So we need to increase the total capacitance by a factor of 260. So we need to increase it from 1060 to 1060 times 260, which is this big quantity. So we need to add a capacitance, which is 1060 times 259, which is about 274 nano farads. All right. Next question is, okay, we found the capacitance. Where should we add this capacitance? Where is this capacitance? At the same place, we have to add this. This effective capacitance is from this node to ground. So we must add this additional 270 nanofarads from this node to ground. So this is where we'll add it. All right. But it turns out that 270 nanofarads is a very large capacitance. So people said, why don't we assume it? Okay, before we go to that, you may, I hope and assume that some of you will ask this question, how is 274 nano large when we have a 10 micro here? This is like, how many times? At least 10,000, 50,000 times this capacitance. So why is this capacitance large? Okay, so compared to this 10 milli, it is of course not large, but the and therefore in fact for, okay, so how do I say this? Okay, 274 nano is large for an integrated circuit op amp. 274 nano is not at all large for a discrete transistor amplifier, and nowadays nobody makes these high performance high gain amplifiers with discrete components. They are all integrated, and of course on integrated circuits one doesn't have these 10 millis either. It is impossible to fabricate a 10 milli capacitor on a chip. It is just too large a value. So this, okay, so for discrete circuits 274 nano is fine, but for integrated circuits it is not fine. So let's discuss this case that we'll assume that 274 nano is large, and what do we do? So people said, why don't we use the Miller effect? So what do we do? Instead of connecting a capacitor from this node to ground, if we connect a capacitor from here to here, then the effective Miller capacitance at the input would be that capacitance times the gain of this stage, which is about 200. All right. So we connect a capacitor here. And now what is the value we need? Here. If we connect a Miller capacitance, let's call it CC, then the effective capacitance between the base of Q5 and ground will be the gain of the third stage times CC. And the gain of third stage is 200, which has to be 274. So the actual capacitance we need to connect is only 1.4 nanofarads, which is of course a much smaller value. So this is what is done. Most integrated circuit amplifiers will have a compensation capacitor connected between the largest, well, at the node where the largest time constant occurs, and it will be connected between the input and output of that stage. All right. So this is dominant pole compensation. Okay. Now, so I simulated this circuit, so we'll just quickly look at the numbers and results, and this will be all. Okay, so this is that same circuit, but now I have put it in a unity gain negative feedback loop. So how do you make a unity gain negative feedback loop with this circuit? By the way, so this is different from our op-amp circuits, because the way we've designed this amplifier, it has only one input, not two inputs. It's a single input amplifier. So this is different from the usual unity gain stuff that we have done with op-amps. So what we do is we connect from the output to the input a resistor 100k, from the input to the source, I mean the input voltage source signal, we connect another 100k, and so now the gain of this closed loop amplifier can be written as R2 by R1 minus R2 by R1, and if because R2 and R1 are equal, the gain is minus 1. Alright, so this is actually unity gain, but a negative minus, it's a, the gain is minus 1, it is not plus 1, but it's the magnitude is 1. Now if you look at these numbers, this is actually this closed loop thing is extremely tricky, and I'll tell you quickly why. For the amplifier we designed, so the amplifier we designed, the five stage, this three stage, it was a nice design exercise for open loop purposes. It is not at all a good, in fact doesn't make a good amplifier for closed loop applications. It is nice only as an academic exercise. The reason is the following. When we designed this, we assumed that the DC voltage at this node was zero. And the DC voltage at this node was about, even in this circuit, is about 7 volts. Alright, it's 6-7 volts. Now let us look at this circuit with the negative feedback. So you have a resistor, there is a 7 volt here, there was a 0 volt here. Now what will happen to the circuit if I connect this with those original voltages? So originally there was supposed to be 0 and 7. When I connect 100k and 100k, what happens? This is very tricky and very, very what shall I say, complicated. So I leave it at that. There is, I don't have the time or the, I think this is a bit advanced, so I'll not go into it. But this amplifier works in the closed loop, or yeah, in closed loop all the transistors stay in the active mode only for a very small range of DC voltages at the in the this voltage source. So earlier we had assumed that this voltage source is only AC, but the, or if this is DC voltage is zero, this some transistor will go into saturation. So it turns out, I don't remember, but it works I think from -7 to -5 or -6 to -4. Only for that small range of DC voltages does this circuit work as an amplifier. Okay, so just remember this. So I have tweaked all these numbers to make sure that it is working. Okay, so what I have done is, let us look at this circuit for different values of this compensation capacitor connected here. Alright, so suppose we start by not putting a capacitor. So suppose we don't put a capacitor here, and what I am applying at the input is a voltage step. So we apply a voltage step at the input, and if there is no capacitor, and this is negative feedback, if there is no capacitor, there is no compensation, the circuit is unstable under negative feedback. So what should we expect? Without a capacitor, we put it under a negative feedback, an unstable circuit, we expect oscillations. So this is nicely, it's showing oscillation. So if there's no C2, the circuit oscillates. This is not a sine wave because there is huge amounts of non-linearities happening, and this has a huge amount of positive feedback. So the phase margin you saw was not -180 degrees. If the phase margin was, I'm sorry, if the phase margin was zero, then this will show a nice sine wave. But this has a huge negative phase margin, in which case this is what the output is likely to look like, because there are lots of different frequencies oscillating. Okay, then I put a 2.9 nanofarads. So the input was going positive to negative, the output will go, well, there is a DC, but input was increasing, the output is decreasing, because this is a -1 gain. Actually this, yeah, okay. But what we see is the output is initially DC, finally DC. It is stable, but there is ringing. So this is kind of an underdamped system, so there is a lot of oscillation. In many applications, this is not desirable. So this is still not good enough. Okay, then I put a 15 nanofarad, and then one sees that there is almost just a little overshoot, but almost no ringing. All right. Now notice this number. This number is different from what was the number we had found. 1.4 nanofarad. Now so a lot of our numbers are approximate because as I said I use this 50 and 5, okay, whatever, that's too much back, but anyway, there are too many approximations that were made. So this number that we arrive at is only a ballpark figure. Eventually one has to sit on spice and tweak this number till one gets the kind of, one goes from here to here to here, and then one gets a nicely non-ringing stable output. So this turns out that for this specific circuit, the compensation capacitor, the Miller compensation capacitor needed is 15 nanofarads. Okay. All right. This is the end of this lecture. Next lecture will be a short lecture. There are two important concepts I had got missed that we'll discuss, and then we'll wind up the course. So the next lecture will be the last lecture of the course. Okay.